says that which passeth knowledge. Like, it just, there's no knowledge to gain about the love of God. It's just too vast. So it's unknown in its fullness. It's unbroken in its ministry. I love that. When I look at the life of a believer and they've died and they've gone on to be with the Lord, Father God, you know, there's part of me. I want to reach out. I want to touch. I want to hold. I want to hear a word again. Just, you know, for me, that's me. We're not able to be loved against Sister Stacy like they can't hug us. They can't say, I love you. It's broken within us. Yeah. But with God, death does not break his love. You're loved as much in life as you're loved in death with God. So, I mean, it's so vast as we think about his love. It's universal, it's offered, it's unknown, it's fullness, it's unbroken, it's ministry. It's unending in its character. The Lord hath appeared to me of old, saying unto me, Jeremiah said, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Like it's been around forever, even before we were. God loved us. Crazy. Crazy. Way before this world was ever formed, God knew us and God loved us. Wrap your mind around that tonight. The love of God. Amen. And then there's nothing that can challenge it. It's just 1 John 3:16. Hereby perceive we the love of God. Because he laid down his life for us, we ought to lay down our life for the brother. You know, we need to rally around and have the same love for others as God has for us. There's more that we use in pastoral care, that's really used with nurses, it's used with anyone who's a caregiver, and it's a very true word, and it's called compassion fatigue. Maybe you've heard of that before. It means you're caring for someone, you're giving, you're caring, and your compassion's exhausted, Sister Tina. Not that you don't love that person, but you're just exhausted. You know, in the realm of God, God never knows compassion fatigue. Like, he never exhausts from giving us love and compassion and care. And then he challenges us to love others the same way they do. That we're not exhausted with the love and compassion and care of God. I gotta hurry. See, it's extraordinary and it's choice that God would love the world. The greatest lover, to the greatest degree, love this company called the world. The whole world. He loves them. He loves the lovable. He loves the unlovable. He loves the ones who their hearts burn and yearn for him. But he loves the one that spurns him. He loves them. And the great thing, we couldn't make God love us more. We couldn't make God love us less. God doesn't work on levels. God loves. And so, he loves unconditionally. Brother Eli, from 1986 to 1990, Franklin Reed was held as a hostage in a prison cell in Lebanon. He gives in his testimony when he was being interviewed by Time Magazine, what was the most difficult thing in those 4 years of being held captive as a prisoner? It wasn't the beatings, it wasn't the starving. He said he knew that he was chained up and he felt like other people was there. Though he was blindfolded and he couldn't see them, he felt like they were there as well. And he said the worst thing that he felt in those 4 years was not having anyone to touch, talk, or to love on him. Wow. We were designed for love. And the greatest lover of all is designed in his design to love us. Wow. He loves the world. The extraordinariness of it, but the expensiveness of his sacrifice, that he gave his only begotten Son. Y'all heard the story before of the man who was dating the girl, and Brother Eli, she looked at him and she said, do you love me? He said, oh, I love you so much. Her grace, she said, do you love me so much that you would die for me? Oh, no. Ours is an undying love. You see, Christ didn't look at it that way. But God sent his only begotten Son with a plan that he would die. How much he loved me, he stretched out his arms. God loves. You know, if you look at John chapter 3, verse number 16, there are 25 words in there. The very center word, word number 13, is Son, S-O-N. At the center of God's love toward us was a Son. Everything about the gospel plan and the Word of God and God's love is centered around His Son, Jesus Christ, which we must believe on and have a regeneration through His work to be saved. The extensiveness of His offer was whosoever, the greatest opportunity. The Word of God says in Romans 10:13, but whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You see, it blows the Calvinistic doctrine out of the water that God only saves certain people and they're predestined. Amen. The Word of God says that whosoever, yes, God knows all things and God knows who will make the choice, but God didn't make them make the choice. They made the choice themselves because God's extent of His love and His relationship that He wants to man is with whosoever would call upon Him would be saved. And then there's this exclusive bestowment that is so simple. Believeth in Him. God's gift by accepting the work of the cross has this exceptional thing in their life. They shall not perish. Always remember and always evangelize. God sends no one. Every man makes their own choice. It won't be because God didn't love them. It won't be because God didn't send His Son. It's because they made a choice. They would walk away. Nicodemus walked away, but thank God for the opportunity he had later to see and understand and hopefully experience salvation through the regeneration of the Spirit of God. And then that person has this blessedness. They shall not perish, but have everlasting life. The greatest gift ever given is I love when I can talk to folks. And I know that their conviction, their belief system hasn't been founded upon the Word of God. But yet, in an unplanned or unwanted pregnancy, they choose to give life. It's a beautiful choice. And so I'll look at them and I'll say, you know, you made a great choice to have and to give. The gift of life. You don't have to have wealth to love and raise a child properly. I think the best case scenario of God's plan, God's way, is a man and a woman, married, committed, one flesh before God raising a child. But if that's not the situation, God gives grace. God can give grace. And so the gift of life is always the best choice. God gave the best choice in giving the gift of life. The sky turned black. Couldn't stand to see His Son bear the sins of the whole wide world, but yet knew His Son must have borne. He could have called 10,000 angels, but He chose to give life. Life is the best choice. Someone have anything you want to share tonight? Apologize, it's been a little bit longer than what I've intended. But I did skip over a lot of my last parts of my notes, so that's in time for refreshment too. Sister Rachel.
Thank you.
She was nice though.
We didn't do much of anything.
Nothing wrong with that. Sometimes you don't need to go running everywhere.
No, she-